despite what the title slide says, we're going to be talking about seven. Ken, if you remember, we talked about the rock cycle. And, you know, when you look at the rock cycle, really, I can make any rock out of any other rock. I can even make it out of an older, same kind of rock. But the sedimentary rock, in particular, we're making from a couple of different ways. We're either breaking down other rocks, making clastic sedimentary rocks out of broken particles that we're putting back together, or we're making sedimentary rocks out of chemical means, or precipitating material out of water, or it's moving through groundwater, or various means in that way. And remember last time we talked about this idea of sorting, how as we take a rock, we break it up, it falls off the cliff, breaks into a bunch of chunks, immediately we can sweep out the silts and clays because it doesn't take a lot of energy to move that stuff out of the system, so off it goes. And as the particles start to move, the smaller ones are going to move first because they take less energy to move. And as these particles move, they break down, finer stuff gets swept out, the corners get knocked off, so particles get rounded, things become more homogeneous, the easier to break down materials break down, and what's left is the durable stuff. So we see this sorting process going from immature, really angular, poorly sorted material to very well sorted, mature material. And energy is kind of a weird way to think about it. So true or false? Sediments with more clay, a greater mix of particle sizes, and more angular fragments, that's typical of mature sediments. Sedimentary rock classification into two chunks. The first is simply going to be the clastic stuff, the gravels, the sands, the muds, these particles that we've broken off of other rocks. The second part, we're going to talk about chemical rocks, things that are precipitating out of solution, things that are due to chemical reactions, that kind of thing. And we're going to be able to break that down into the inorganic versus the biochemical, things that are put together like shell fragments. And we'll see how biology plays a role in making sedimentary rocks. Okay, this is kind of a neat way to summarize how chemical or how sedimentary rocks kind of fit together, especially the clastic sedimentary rocks. Because we're looking at changing energy levels and different environments, different settings, are going to have different energy levels associated with them. We're going to start up here at the source area. And the source area is simply where we start breaking the rock apart, where we weather the mountains to start making the materials to make sediment. And we're going to move down, and we're going to essentially go from the source area downstream, eventually reaching the shore at the beach, and then sweeping materials offshore into the basin. Okay, so that's kind of the way we're going to go. So we're going to start up here, and I want to look at a couple of rock types that we would find right at the very beginning of this process. This is what we're looking at. Things like frost heat, weathering, erosion at the base of the cliff, materials starting to move downstream, still pretty big, and one of the first kind of rocks that we're going to find is this. It's called a breccia. And you can see that it's really poorly sorted, right? We've got some big chunks, we've got some little stuff. Look how angular this stuff is, and yet a few of the pieces are just kind of starting to get rounded off. Essentially, this is weathered debris that didn't make it very far away from its source. It didn't have a chance to break down and get sorted. It's just been re-cemented and made right back into a sedimentary rock. So breccia tells you that, and the fact that you've got all these angular pieces in this finer matrix, these silts and clays, pretty obvious what's going on. If I can move this weathered material downstream a little bit, start to kind of break it down, the next thing I end up with is a conglomerate. You think of conglomeration and stuff. It looks a lot like a breccia does. It's poorly sorted, same as a breccia, but look at these pebbles, how rounded they're starting to become. I've finally got this stuff moving downstream a little bit. I'm knocking the corners off the pieces, and what would have been a breccia has now become a conglomerate. So, conglomerates would be considered moderately mature because the pebble size fraction consists of rounded fraction, the rounded fragments, despite the fact that it's still fairly poorly sorted. What do you think? Now, what does it mean to say moderately mature? What does that really mean? Well, the class says true. That's what it means. And actually, this is a fairly good definition, kind of a break point, to put breccias and conglomerates kind of up toward the source area. And when you start to see conglomerates, you're starting to get some rounding, a little bit of sorting, not much, but a little. And that's kind of where you start to see a moderate amount of maturity start to creep into the system. You sure don't have any breccias, do you? That's still very immature. But with conglomerates, you're starting to see some. So I'd say this would be true. So here we are. We're breccias, and notice conglomerates. Now we've kind of gotten down into this area where we're starting to see some breakdown and sorting of the material. The next thing we're going to do as we move down is get into the realm of sandstones. And there's a wide range of sandstones, from sandstones that are still up here near the conglomerate end of things to sandstones that are down here on the beach that have gone all the way down the river and had a lot of maturity going on. So let's kind of take a look. These are all sandstones, but look at how different they look. Here I've got a sandstone. We call this a quartz aronite. In this case, it's made up of nothing but quartz grains. So is that mature or immature?
Mature.
Yeah. It's all that's left. I've broken down the feldspars. I've gotten rid of the muscovite and the biotite. I'm just down to the durable quartz grains. And notice they're all kind of the same size. And they're all rounder. So quartz aronite is also what we'd call a very clean sandstone, because we've gotten rid of all the other stuff. It's just quartz. Here's an arcosic sandstone. What do I mean by arcosic? Well, I'll let you kind of guess at it. Look at the color. What color is that? It's kind of a pink salmon color. What mineral do you know with a pink salmon color? Case-spar. So this is a sandstone that still has some case-spar in it. So it hasn't broken down, it hasn't cleaned up like a quartz aronite. It's still fairly mature, but not as mature as a quartz aronite. So this is kind of a dead giveaway. So notice they're both sandstones, but if I put the word arcosic in front of anything, it just says, and there's some case-spar in it. Just kind of shorthand. So you can see here a lot of quartz, but every once in a while you get a little grain of case spar. this stuff. What color is it? Gray. So that becomes part of its name. And if you look at it, it's just a mishmash of mineralogy. It's got a little of everything in it. You can see quartz grains, you can see feldspar grains, you can see biotite, muscovite. It's all sorts of stuff. So we call it a gray whack. This is kind of the junk drawer in your kitchen. Remember the drawer that all the things you don't know where to put them, they end up in that drawer, just kind of thrown in. Now, this is that for rocks. So we've got all this stuff here, still a pretty immature rock. This is up toward the conglomerate end of things. So I've got a whole range of rocks. They're all sandstones, but they all show different degrees of sorting and rounding. Look at a pebble here. Look at how rounded some of this is. A lot of sorting still to go on. So you can see there's a real range to sandstones. Here's an Aeolian sandstone. Whenever I use this term Aeolian, right away you know it's windblown. It's something that got deposited out of the breeze. And this is an outcrop at Zion National Park. And Zion is noted for its old sand dunes. These are ancient sand dunes that have been made into sandstone sedimentary rock. And you can still see the slip faces, those are the surfaces that the dune was growing and building and migrating across the area. So the structure of the dune is still preserved in the sandstone. And notice how fine-grained it is. It isn't as coarse as that quartz aronite that we were looking at. This is really fine-grained stuff, and look at how clean it is. I mean, there is nothing else except little frosted sand grains. So this is a characteristic of the windblown sandstones, is they tend to be very fine-grained because the wind doesn't have as much energy as the stream in general. And the grains get a little frosted as they bang into each other in the wind. It's a beautiful Aeolian sandstone. Yeah. It probably will, if it doesn't erode away first. It needs to kind of get buried a little bit to get cemented, and who knows what's going to happen. My guess is before that happens, another glacier is going to come along and take it out. So, but yeah, that's a possibility. Okay, now here's kind of a dichotomy. We said that the silts and the clays were going to wash out of the system first because they're the finest grain, least amount of energy, right? So poof, off they go. That's the stuff that's in suspension in the water, making the water brown. So I might see these back in a swamp, or if they kind of stay in the stream and keep going, this stuff's just going to go right past the beach, out into the deep basin, and the deep basin, the water's going to be quiet. Once I get out there past the wave zone, things kind of quiet down, and those silts and clays are just going to settle out and coat the base and bottom. So I'm going to find these mudstone type of rocks in a couple different locations along the